friends, Heidi here from Rain Country. God is good all the time. And today we're going to be talking about stinging nettle. I'm going to be talking about many of the benefits of stinging nettle, why you should grow it, how I grow it, and how I put it away for long-term storage and use it throughout the year. So starting off, you can see I have a basket here or a colander full of fresh stinging nettle, and I just cut this morning. This here on one of my dehydrator trays, I have more out there dehydrating, hooked up to our solar power. And this is all dry, and I'm going to show you what I do with that here in just a minute. Now, first, let's talk about some of the benefits of stinging nettle. So I took notes, so hopefully I won't forget anything. Even when I take notes, I still tend to forget everything I want to say. So I want to talk about the nutrients that you can find in stinging nettle. Stinging nettle is just loaded with nutrients. And this is the Urtica dioica. That's the Latin name for it, the botanical name. So the nutrients would be A, it's very high in vitamin C, K, which I believe would be K1, and then several different B vitamins, though I didn't quite nail down exactly which one. It does have several B vitamins, which are just excellent. Also high in calcium, iron, magnesium, phosphorus, and potassium, and also has amino acids, and is surprisingly high in protein, which is one of the main reasons why I decided to grow it. For a vegetable, it's pretty high in protein, kind of like kale is. Now, some health benefits of the stinging nettle would be that it's very detoxifying. It has anti-inflammatory properties, both when taken internally and when used externally. So there was a time they used to use the stinging nettle. This was a common practice in Rome. They would actually hit the swollen knuckles of someone with arthritis and actually allow it to sting, because the chemicals in the stinging is what helped relieve the pain and bring down the swelling of the arthritis, and actually helped heal it because of the increased blood flow. And I've come to find out they actually still do such things today in different places. That might not be for everyone, but apparently it is helpful and it does work. It's also very beneficial to reproductive health for both men and women, for cardiovascular health, for liver detoxification. It's also help at regulating blood pressure and blood sugar. So if you're diabetic or you have high blood pressure, this is something you can consider, but you have to, it's one of those things, just like anything, you don't want to take an herb that's going to help with these things at the same time that you're taking medications for those. But if you're like me and you're one that's looking for ways to get off of the medications that you're currently on, we are currently on none now, but this is just one way you can do that. I honestly believe that most, if not all, people that are on high blood pressure medicine can get off, and most people that are diabetics can heal themselves. That's what I believe, just from what I've learned over the past several years in researching these things. Stinging nettle also has styptic properties. So if it's used on, like the juice from it is used on a wound, it can help stop or slow down blood flow, much like yarrow does. Yarrow is the same way. It's also good for eczema and acne. This can be both taken, you know, internally as a tea, or used as a tea applied topically to these things. So helping from both the inside and the outside in. Inside out, outside in. And then the last thing I wanted to talk about as far as health, this was the number one reason why I chose to start growing my own stinging nettle, and that was for thyroid health. Now, those who've been following us for a while know that Patrick and I used to be on thyroid medications, both of us, and we were each on them for 15 years apiece, you know, believing that, oh, if you have to take this or you're going to die, if you can't ever go off them, you have to take them for the rest of your life. But the more I started researching health and different things, I just became more and more convinced there was no need for us to be on thyroid medication, and started looking for natural ways to get off of it. And that is exactly what we did, and it's been about 7 years now that we've been off the thyroid medication and doing great. And so The great thing about the nettle is it's not just for people with hypothyroidism like we had, but those with hyperthyroidism or Hashimoto's. It's all the way across the board, because what it does is it helps regulate your thyroid. So if you have high producing thyroid, this will help bring it down a little bit. If yours is a little bit sluggish, it'll help give it a boost. It's such an incredible herb. I just love it so much. And again, I'm always surprised it's one of the ones I forget to mention. Another really good thing you can do with your nettle, after you dry it, powder it up, add it to your chicken's feed. It's really good for chickens. And chickens will eat raw nettle too. It's really, really good for them, and it will help give them more healthier eggs, and also good for your pets. So when I dehydrate my stinging nettle, the main thing I do with it is I mix it in with other great garden greens like kale, carrot tops, dandelion greens, grape leaves, strawberry leaves, plantain, borage leaves, just about anything green, beet greens that I grow out there that is edible. I will dry it up, I mix it all together, and then it goes into what I call my mixed greens blend that goes in just about anything. And now I've come to the point, because I've been craving the greens so much, and our greens are just starting to come in at the time that I'm shooting this video, I'm getting fresh kale. I've been making a tea out of the mixed greens every night and just loving it and making me just feel so good all the way around. And then the stinging nettle and the grape leaves are two of the things that make up most, and the dandelion leaves. Those three things make up the most of what's in those greens. You know, the amaranth leaves and kale and all that stuff do make up a good part too, but those top three that I mentioned there are what's mostly in it. Since I know I'm going to be getting the most stinging nettle I've got for my plant so far, I plan on not mixing all of it in with my mixed greens blend, but keeping some of it separate for doing other things, of making a tea just with a nettle, or for, like I said, mixing in with the chicken's feed. So now what I do is, once the stinging nettle is fully dry, it deactivates the chemicals in there that make it sting. So what I do is I just crush it up with my fingers. You don't have to do this. You can throw it in a coffee grinder or in a food processor, however you want to do it. Just make sure you check for any thick stems that might not get pulled off of there. That those tend to take longer to dry, and I just pull those out. And so I just crush it up like that. And then after I get it all crushed up like that, I simply put it in my jar. And so what will happen with this is I'll keep filling the jar until I've got it completely full, and you know, as I keep dehydrating more nettle, and then I'll put my lid on there, and then I'll vacuum seal it and then just keep making more jars like that. Now, if you're interested in how I vacuum seal my jars, I do it with just a brake bleeder. I'll go ahead and link to my video I did on just vacuum sealing right up here, so you can check that out. Some other things that I like to do with the nettle, what I just started doing with the fresh nettle, though I've added fresh nettle as I picked it to meals as I've cooked them. One of the things I finally did for the first time last night for dinner was I took the leaves, I boiled them, and we ate them like spinach. And what I found, I thought I was gonna like it better with vinegar, because that's how I always liked my cooked spinach, but I found I liked it best with a little butter and some salt. I thought it was delicious. It was way better tasting than I actually thought it was going to be. So when it comes to harvesting your nettle, that's the other thing I want to talk about. You can actually grab the front part of the leaves here. The stingers are not on the front part of the leaves. They're on the back side of the leaves. That's the part that stings. And so you can do this. I typically will wear gloves. I still manage to get stung sometimes, but to me, it's really not that big a deal. And as long as you have some plantain or some dock, which usually grows close to your nettle, you can just rub a little bit on that and it's gonna take the sting out. I just don't bother, but some people are highly allergic, so you may even wanna wear some kitchen gloves when you do this, some big, thick rubber gloves. And I usually take the stem usually has stickers on it, needles on it too, but I usually try to pull all this stuff off and take the thickest part of the stems off, though you can use those too. I just try to focus on the leaves. And then how I grow the nettle, some some people ask, well, do you border it off, put a fence around it to keep people from accidentally falling into it? No, I personally don't. Right now, we don't have any young kids running around here, but even where it's at, it's not likely that's going to happen. But you can do that if you want. However, I grow ours right under a bedroom window. So this serves a couple of purposes. It's out of the way. It's not out there with the rest of the vegetables. It's not right in the middle of the garden. Though it is good to know that growing your nettle among your other herbs is actually very nourishing to the herbs. But when it comes to harvesting the other herbs, that could be literally a pain. But I put it under the window, so not only is it out of the way, it also adds a measure of defense. So if someone's getting into the nettle, that means they're probably trying to climb into the window, and they shouldn't be, and they deserve to get the heck stung out of them. So, you know, that's one of the reasons why I plant it there. Now, in these pictures that I'm showing you, keep in mind, the nettle had just started growing because it's early spring. It will get up to 3 feet tall if you let it. The best way to deal with your nettle, I did do a video a couple years ago when I first started harvesting it, but what I have found, I do it differently now, is I cut it pretty much clear down to the ground. I'll leave about that much. Cut it clear down, and it will get thicker, it'll get bigger, and it will just keep coming back throughout the season. Eventually it will go to seed. At that point you want to probably finish up harvesting your leaves. They're not as nutritious at that point once your plant has gone to seed, but there's a lot of nutrition in those seeds if you want to save those seeds as well. So just some things to consider. And you know, some people may grow in areas, like I know nettle grows wild around here. But for me, I like to grow it right on my property because most likely I'm not going to remember to go out and harvest it. And this was important enough for my health, knowing that we needed all these nutrients that were in here in our diet personally, that I wanted to grow it right here so it was easy to get to and I wouldn't forget, like I always do with the chanterelles every year. We love chanterelles, yet we always forget because life gets so busy. It's right at the time of year where everything is the busiest as far as harvesting our grapes and all that kind of stuff. And apples, and so we tend to forget to get out there and get the chanterelles. Well, I don't want that to happen with this stinging nettle, so it grows here. But a lot of people live in places where it grows wild everywhere. Most people do. And so you can always just make a day of it. I know people that do that. Get your rubber gloves and a few bags, and just go out there and harvest a bunch. And you can do what I did here. You can choose to put it in like Ziploc bags or food saver bags. Then you can use it for like a spinach type replacement, like doing like we did last night for dinner. And you know, but again, dehydrating it up, let's say you don't like the flavor of it cooked or whatever, dehydrating it up and sprinkling it into things is excellent. It's just a really good way to get that and some other really beneficial greens into your diet, into your family's diet, without you even noticing it's there. Especially when you add it to soups that have a lot of flavor, you're not going to notice the taste of the dried kale or the dried dandelion leaves or the dried nettle leaves. You just won't. I mean, it's unless you put way too much in there, it's not going to be noticeable. I usually put about a handful like this into a pot of soup. So, but I also add it to casseroles. I also add it to meatloaves and to meatballs and the breakfast sausages that I make. Pretty much anything, gravies and sauces, including my Italian sauces, anything I can get it in to make it healthy. You can put it in your fruit smoothies too if you want. And it's pretty likely you're not going to notice the flavor, especially if you got a lot of real strong tasting fruits in there. You're not going to notice the flavor. It'll just change the color a bit, and then you're still getting all those great vitamins and minerals into your diet. So that's it for today on the stinging nettle. I'll probably be talking more about it down the road. If you have any more questions on this, I'm sure there's something I forgot to mention. So go ahead and put your questions in the comment section down below. And also, if you have ways that you like to use your stinging nettle, how do you use it? What kind of things do you use it in? How do you preserve it? Go ahead and share that with us so that we can also learn from you. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed this video and that you learned something new. Thanks for watching. Take care and God bless.